What I'm going to do is I'm going to share a bit of my story and our church's story, and then I'm going to share 10 reasons why we need to start churches in small towns. Okay, these are just from our experience. And then, I don't know how much, then I want to share, we've launched three vineyards in small towns, and we're launching another one in September. Okay, so these are towns of 4,500, and then a depressed industrial town of 30,000, a shrinking industrial town, then another town of 4,500, and then this fall, we're starting another campus in a town of 10,000. And I just want to share the stories, because each of those, I want to give you a picture of what exactly goes into this, because actually quite a bit goes into it. And actually more goes into it than when we're planting a church. I mean, these are churches, but they're campuses of a single church, okay? So I want to share those stories. And then, this will probably just start tomorrow. Tomorrow I want to talk about how the overall system works and how leadership, everything is leadership. I mean, I'm over church planning, starting new campuses, and sending out missionaries at our church. And all of that is your leadership systems. And I want to talk about how it's like Jesus said, right? We don't need to pray for harvest. There is plenty of harvest, but we need to pray for workers, and we need to think through how do we develop a culture of leadership mobilization within our churches. So that's what we'll talk about tomorrow. So first, let me share a bit of my story. You can see I have real small town credentials here. My daughter took this picture. She was trying to win a Extreme Dad Makeover contest. And I guess somebody else got a rattier picture of their dad. But this is me and my, if you know your overalls, you know, those are not farmer overalls, those are carpenter overalls. So that's what I grew up doing, was building homes with my dad. But I came to Christ as a teenager. My older brother Dave is 2 years older than me, and he was consistently a bad influence on my life, right? He would take me places I shouldn't go and have me try things I shouldn't try. And, you know, he would keep my parents awake at night. You know, where's Dave? What's he doing? And then what's he trying to get Jim to do, kind of thing. But when I was a junior in high school and he was in college, we grew up in a Mennonite church in Morton, Illinois, and he came to Christ through the charismatic movement in the Mennonite church, and he was radically saved, filled with Holy Spirit, and then all of a sudden, he's trying to take me to church instead of to R-rated movies with fake ID, you know? And I just stood back and watched for a while, because you never knew with Dave, you know, what he was going to be trying this month. But, I mean, it was real. And I came to Christ through his influence. And fast forward for, you know, college, get married, all that stuff, called to ministry. For 12 years, Vicki and I served as Mennonite missionaries and pastors. And the first place we were in, now this is how rural it was, okay? The nearest, see if you can beat this, okay? The nearest telephone was 3 miles away. And we were one of the few families in town. No one had indoor plumbing. We were one of the few families with an outhouse in our African village, okay? So see if you can beat that. A village of 500 people. But so it seemed like we were moving to a big town when we moved to, took a pastorate in a town of 1,000 people in the middle of cornfields in Illinois, okay? After that. So those were the first 12 years of our ministry. We came, that's a whole story in itself, but we came into the vineyard in 1992. And I came onto the team at the Urbana Vineyard. I've actually been on the team there twice. But anyway, that's a whole story in itself. But one thing I wanted to share, because this is just part of my story, is I'm a small group guy. I'm just like, write books. For 8 years, all I did was do consulting and training on small groups. And in the middle of that, I worked for two different parachurch ministries doing that. And in the middle of that, or actually just a couple years into that, I thought, we don't know what we're doing. You know, we're helping churches with small groups, and some of them are doing great, and some of them are struggling. And I looked at the other small group ministries, and they were having the same experience. And so I thought, you know, I don't think anybody knows what they're doing. Because, you know, you'd have this church that would, their small groups would go gangbusters. The church down the road, using the same model, it wasn't working. And then you'd have, that's using model A, and then you'd have another church using model B, and it was going great, and another church using model B, it wasn't going great. Trying just as hard. So I did a PhD in organizational communication just to research why are these small groups growing and these small groups aren't growing. And then we looked at church systems. Why are these churches doing well with small groups and these churches aren't? And I can just tell you basically, it's a little more complicated than that. You have to buy my book on the book table if you want the full story. But the most fascinating thing we found out was the thing that made the most difference in small groups, like why are these small groups growing and these small groups aren't growing? It was something no one saw, which was the prayer life of the leader. So it radically changed how we approached ministry, just ministry in general. Like, we better teach people to pray instead of teaching them all these other things we were teaching them. And then when we looked at what makes small group systems grow, like why is this church succeeding with small groups and these churches aren't? We surveyed 3,000 small group leaders in 200 churches. It had nothing to do with which models they were using, but whether the leaders were being coached. So anyway, so there you've got 7 years of research in two words, prayer and coaching. More recently, I'm over small groups, leadership, training, and missions at our church, okay? And I have a bunch of people now that help with small groups and oversee that, so that's just part of what I do. But I wanted to share, so that's about me. Now, I wanted to share our church's journey into multi-site. And one thing I'll tell you on this, this is the most common mistake with multi-site, okay? But I'll correct it right now. You never call them satellites, okay? Because that implies you've got something little, less important, revolving around something larger, more important. So we call them campuses, or you can call them sites. I like campuses, actually. We learned that immediately when we started researching that, because we would call them satellites. And the churches doing this were like, don't ever use that word. At our church, that's like a $5 fine, okay? So We had to be corrected, and I'll correct you. But this is how it started for us. And there were really three different things that came together in unexpected ways. And one was, I'll tell you what happened in my life, and then what happened in our senior pastor's life, and then what we saw happening in our church. So these are the three things. First of all, I was teaching, this is what I do, I was teaching a small group seminar, and Ross was there. I don't know. I was teaching a seminar in Champaign, Urbana. You brought a Harley employee down from Tomahawk. And, I mean, nobody else in the room saw this. But I was teaching, we were looking at different small group models. This was a more in-depth small group seminar. This was like a pastor's seminar. And I was teaching about John Wesley's small group model. John Wesley had this phenomenal small group methodology that was so methodical that they called them the Methodists, okay? And it used different types of small groups at different levels. And as that came to America through Wesley and Asbury and their followers, this became an amazing church planting movement where they were planting two churches a day in the country. And their goal was, they figured no one would travel more than 3 miles to go to church because they either had to walk or get their family in a, you know, buggy or on horseback or something. So they thought, nobody's going to travel more than 3 miles. Let's put a church every 6 miles. This is the amazing thing. They succeeded. So that even today, there are more Methodist churches in the United States than there are post office. And, we're in rural areas. You know where those buildings are, right? There's one every 6 miles. There is. And some of those are closing now, and, you know, it's a long story of how they lost their way. But as I was teaching on that, it was one of those times in your life, you know, where there's a few times in your life where God speaks so clearly that it's like an audible voice. And as I was teaching on that, I heard God say, "You can do that today." And just so it's just kind of like, just like, okay, people can drive 10 or 15 miles to, they probably won't drive more than that. We need a vineyard every 25 miles. You know, so just like, boom, like that's what you're supposed to do, is a vineyard every 25 miles. So that happened. Then later that year, this was 2005 and then 2006, a friend of mine, Dwight Mirable, who co-wrote, we researched the book, Small Groups Big Impact Together, and then he was researching church planting movements, okay? So there's these amazing church planting movements taking place in different parts of the world, and he's researching these, and he's like, "Jim, would you help me with this? Because I'm more the statistician." And I start helping him with a research project and researching church planting movements. And my mind's just getting stretched on this, like, we can put in place leadership mobilization systems and discipleship systems that just radically advance the gospel. And then I had an extremely vivid dream with three scenes in it. And in the first scene, I was driving through the countryside, and it was just totally rural country, and it was harvest time, and people were bringing in the harvest. And Okay, so that's scene one. Scene two, I'm out of the harvest, I'm in this desert, I'm taken into this just palatial building. And it was so vivid, it was like realer than real. And this building was like marble, it was just like so luxurious. And people are taking me somewhere in this building, and I'm like, where are these people taking me? And then I get somewhere, and it's, I realize this is a morgue, and I'm supposed to lead a funeral service there. And then the third scene, so totally changes scene. I'm a biker, okay? There's this new bike trail had been put in. I mean, for real, this new bike trail had been put in going past the home where I grew up. They tore out the railroad tracks, put in this cool biking trail, which I'd never ridden on. And I'm there, I'm gonna go bike on this trail. And you know, you put your bike on your car and you go to the trailhead, and then you take your bike off the bike rack and you bike on the trail. And I could not find the trailhead. So I like wake up, and I immediately know what the three scenes are. Scene one means you're supposed to plant churches in rural areas. There's this amazing harvest there. Scene two is you've just moved into an $8 million building, which we had. Get out of there. That's not where the harvest is. Get out of there. You know, like, I mean, actually, this was like the word to me, this was like, not to our church, like, leave the dead to bury the dead. Get out of there where the harvest is. That's where I'm bringing the kingdom, okay? So, I mean, you read the books on this, it's like, don't use the attractional model, use the missional model. But, yeah, whatever. It, for me, it was like, your ministry is not in that building, it's out there. And the third scene, what the third scene meant was, I'm not telling you how to do this. You're not going to be able to figure this out. You're going to have trouble getting on the trail. So the next few years, that was my story. The next few years was like, God, you told me what to do and not how to do it. And it's like Joel said, I would, like, you hear this whole multi-site thing was starting to take off and people write books about it. And, you know, you just, like, that, I mean, there's kind of two thoughts. One is that can't work, and if it does work, it's not biblical, kind of, right? But this is what I want you to realize about, and I actually didn't think this through till this week, okay? So I'm preparing for this conference. And, you know, that word, which had been very real and had been very guiding to me and still is guiding to me about you can do what John Wesley did, we can do that today. I sat back and thought, this week, thinking about this talk, what was Wesley's, what was it that held him, what was it that the Methodists had to overcome to plant churches every 6 miles? What was it they had to overcome? They didn't have enough preachers, and these rural churches couldn't support somebody full time. That they did not let that stop them. So they basically did multi-site. Okay, we'll just have one person cover 4 locations. We don't have enough preachers? Okay, there's a way around that. Let's figure out a way around that. Okay, they can't support, not each of these little country churches can support one person, that's fine, because that person's preaching at 4 places. You know, so all over these Methodists, and then I just thought about this. I mean, this is amazing what they did. I never really thought about the brilliance of this. I mean, this is what they did. I'm not commending this. They originally moved those preachers every year, every year. And I told Vicki this week, I never thought about the brilliance of that. You only need one Christmas sermon. You only need one Mother's Day sermon. You only need one Easter sermon. You know, because next year, you're in another place. But what they did, what Wesley did, was Wesley separated preaching from pastoring because they were not the pastors. And you can read the early church Methodist literature, and there were pastors in those locations that did not move. And they were called the class meeting leaders. They were the home group leaders. And so, basically, they're piping in sermons. But it's not dissimilar, because like what our campus pastors tell us, we've got four campus pastors now, okay? It's a long story, we had five, but we have five campuses. And we had a campus pastor at the main location, but we don't right now. But anyway, three of those four can actually preach very well. They prefer not to. They have 15 hours more a week to do outreach and leadership mobilization. So anyway, I'm just trying to get you thinking outside the box. So this is taking place with me, and this thing's going on where I literally don't know. I don't know if I'm supposed to do this at my church or if I'm supposed to do this in Uganda. I literally don't. And I'm like I'm going to the Vineyard National Conference, and I'm going to every missions partnership meeting. Because I'm trying to figure out, first of all, God, what are you doing? And how am I supposed to fit into this? And is it in East Central Illinois, or where is this thing? And, you know, as I get frustrated, and I'm like, God, you told me to do this, and you didn't tell me how to do it. And then he'd say, I told you you wouldn't know how to do this. You know, kind of like, I told you this would take you time to figure it out. So just be encouraged. You're going to figure this out. So then, in the midst of this, our senior pastor comes up on 30 years in ministry. He started our church 30 years ago, and he started in pastoral ministry at age 30, and he felt like God tell him, at that time, he felt like God tell him, you're going to pastor this church for 40 years. So he's coming up on 30 years, and he's like, God, what do you want me to do in the last 10 years? And as he seeks God about that, he feels like God says to him, in the next 10 years, I want you to plant 10 churches, start 10 new campuses, and send out 10 missionaries. Okay? So it's what our church calls the 10-10-10 vision. It is like the core of what we feel called to do right now. And we're a few years into that. Meanwhile, something else is taking place. We're just looking at what is God doing in our church. So we're in Urbana, Illinois, which is the county seat of Champaign County, Illinois. And so we're right in the middle of the county, university town surrounded by very small towns. And we're noticing more and more people are coming from outside our county, which means they're driving more than 20 miles, right? Which is kind of like, that's my thing. Oh, no, it doesn't. And we look at the statistics, which we do an all-church survey every year or two, and we see that those who are driving more than 20 miles are churched, not in small groups, and not serving in ministries. And it's a fourth of our church. It was exactly 25% of our church. And it was a growing percentage of our church. And we're realizing we're not reaching those towns. We're reaching Christians in those towns who then come here and do not get involved in ministry or in a small group. And I'm the small group pastor, and I've got small groups in those same towns that those people are driving from, and the people in those small groups are not coming to our church. The leaders are. So there's this disconnect. We're reaching two different groups of people in those towns, some through small groups and some through worship, but it's not the same people. And we're like, this is dysfunctional. And people would bring people from their towns, and Christians will travel more than 20 miles to come to church, but non-Christians will not. And the Christians, they would invite their non-Christian friends, but they would not come. Or they might come once. Meanwhile, I go out to these small groups, and I talk to people who were new Christians or not even Christians yet, and they're like, I'll come when you start a church in this town. But they're like, I drive 15 miles to get to this small group. I'm not driving another 50 to go to your Sunday service. So we're starting to, we just like, okay, we got to do something out there. And then we start this journey of learning. And we start reading, okay? So there's really three key books on this. The Multi-Site Revolution by Jeff Surratt, Greg Lagone, and Warren Bird. There's another book called Multi-Site Churches, which is also very good. And they talk to some vineyard people in those. Some of the churches they talk to in there are vineyard churches. There's about 20 vineyards doing multi-site right now. And then there's a follow-up book to the first book called The Multi-Site Road Trip, also by Jeff Surratt, Warren Bird, and Greg Lagone. So we start reading the books, I'm talking, Hap, when should we start taking people to conferences? And Hap just has an amazing sense of timing. He's like, not yet. And then in 2008, he's like, okay, this is the time. And this is why I was telling Joel, it really changes people's paradigm when they actually visit it, because it breaks down the stereotypes. And we had a friend who started coming to the Urbana Vineyard. Her life, she got healed. She just tremendous breakthroughs in her life. She'd been going to a Methodist church before that was kind of dead. And then she took a job that was near one of our new campuses. And I'm like, I'm like, you should check this out. And she's, oh no. And I'm like, yeah, we'll go with you. So we take her to this new campus, and she's like, well, this is way more exciting than the Urbana Vineyard. You know, because for her, the Urbana Vineyard had been life-changing for her. And then she was just shocked how the vibe was like ratcheted up a notch at the new campus. And then we start going to conferences and visiting multi-site churches, and we start just networking, calling the vineyards. At that time, there was just a handful of vineyards doing multi-site. I mean, we're calling other churches too, but we especially wanted to know how it was working in other vineyards, and you know, did it fit your values, and so on. And then we just started doing it. Okay, so this is what I want you to understand about this. Is we were double-minded. Okay, so, you know, we're taking people to conferences, giving them books, telling them, you can do this. And then I want you to just to know, because, like, it would be easy for me to tell this story, and it sounded like we knew what we were doing, and we were listening to God, and we were obeying God, and we had our act all together. You know, like, this could be airbrushed. Which it's very easy to do in conferences, but there's three people from my church here, okay? So I decided not to do that. But the first two people then that stepped forward and said, okay, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna start a campus in my town, we're like, we don't think you can do this. And they actually, if they had not been tenacious and persistent and pushed past, the major barrier then was us. But the first two managed to do that. It's a little easier now. And then we said, we're with you, you know, we're going to help you with this. And then we really could have been a lot more helpful. This is just like a couple of our ministries, like to pull this off. This is the thing with multi-site. Like when Michael was telling me this last month, Michael Gallen and others were like we actually aren't doing church planning right, because we kind of do it like you were saying, like, hey, here you go. That's kind of how we've done church planning, even the one we sent out last year. And, you know, they didn't call us either, so we just assumed they didn't want our help, the church plans. But if it's if it's one of our campuses, this is ours. This is like adding another service. You know, we're going to make sure everything's there, everything's working. You know? So our children's ministry and our worship ministry, I mean, they went all out. This is going to be awesome worship. This is going to be great kids' ministry. But there were other parts of our systems that really didn't help. So this is just like a small illustration of something that was happening in a very big way. So I go to the Danville campus. I mean, they hadn't started yet, but they're meeting. You know, we haven't launched, but they're meeting. They're getting ready to start. We're working on systems. We're working on things. And I'm like, this coffee tastes terrible. And, you know, that's like our motto at our church. You know, casual atmosphere, serious faith, great coffee. You know, so, I mean, it does not have our DNA if it's Folgers, right? It should be French roast Colombian. So I'm like, this coffee's terrible. And they said, we asked the kitchen for the vineyard blend, and they wouldn't give it to us. Okay? And then I say, you know, then I'm like, these graphics are terrible on the walls, you know? And they're like, we asked the communication team for signs, and they wouldn't help us. So do you see where, like, they succeeded in spite of us, not because of us, because in a lot of ways, we would not help them. So that's my last point on that. I've still got a half an hour to go that they allotted me, but do you need a break? You need some of you do. Okay, if you need one, take one, okay? Yeah, because we'll take a mini break here, a little later, a break. Here's 10 reasons why we want to start vineyards, or if you're not vineyard, other churches in small towns, okay? And I think this is in your notes. But you have to fill in the blanks. This just surprised us how cheap it is. You know, Joel mentioned they went to they visited our Paxton Vineyard. Paxton's the county seat of Ford County. Ford County is the last county, like, established in Illinois. It's like this weird shape. It's all the land nobody wanted in Illinois. It is because of some pernicious weed that grew there that they couldn't farm the land at that time. But so Joel mentioned this. So we are in the center of town, 6,000 square feet, $1,000 a month. So we're renting this for $1,000 a month. It's a storefront at the very center of town, and there's apartments above it, and the campus pastor's like, there's 2,000 square feet in the basement that we get in that $1,000, and the campus pastor's like, could you throw in an apartment? We need an office. So they throw in a one-bedroom apartment with that $1,000 a month that's just been remodeled. It's gorgeous. Brand new carpet, brand new paint, brand new kitchen stuff in there. And so it's like, I mean, we don't spend, the next place we went, Danville, they We found a building, they were like this building. I mean, the biggest problem we had in Danville, where there were so many empty buildings, we looked at dozens. And there was one place that they said, this is for sale for $2.1 million. A hospital, it had outgrown this physical therapy building, is like 12 years old. We'll rent it to you for $19,000 a month. I mean, we don't even have people yet, you know? And finally, you know, Happy's just a fantastic wheeler dealer. And Happy meets with the hospital administration. And the hospital is down the street from our main campus. And he's like, you know, we let you use our parking lot every year during the county fair, because they park, the hospital employees park at the county fairgrounds, but when the county fair is going on, they've got to park at the Vineyard. And you guys use our building every year for the flu clinic. Could we use this building? Oh, yeah, you can use it. You just need to pay utilities. Yeah. So then they ask us, they said, we have an offer on the building. They come back to us after we've launched. They come back to us and say, we have an offer for $250,000. But we'll sell it to you for $250,000. So we go to the leadership of the Danville Vineyard, and they're like, no, that's too much money. It's 15,000 square feet, okay? New. It's beautiful. They're like, that's too much. Let them sell it to Cellular One or whatever. So it falls through with Cellular One, and they come back to us, and they're like, would you guys like to make an offer? And we bought it for $150,000. 15,000 square feet. It's a block off the main drag. I mean, I wish it was on the main drag. Tilton, that's just south of us, just south of Danville, is, you know, they're telling us, hey, you can just move to Tilton. We'll give you land in Tilton. So we're looking at land in Tilton right now because it's near the interstate. But it's just, I mean, it's incredible how much cheaper it is in these small towns. I could go on and on. I mean, we're renting in Charleston, where we're launching this fall. We're renting, Charleston is a small university town. 10,000 people in the town, 12,000 people at the university. We're renting what used to be the University Baptist Church, which is across the street from the administration building, from the main building of the university. It's across the street. $1,000 a month we're renting that for. It's only, you know, it's only like 6,000 square feet. But, and the rent's going to go up when we launch to 1,500. But again, we're just like blown away by how cheap it is. So that's why you should plan in small towns, okay? It's cheap. This is another thing that's just shocked us. There is no competition. Unfortunately, there is no competition. When we move into a small town, every town we're in, this is just the way it's happened. We thought, let's go to every town with a Walmart. But actually, we're like, no, these towns are too small to have Walmart. Some of them are too small. Paxton and Sullivan are too small to have Walmarts. But when we come in with Holy Spirit-oriented church with excellent kids ministry and excellent worship, there's no competition, unfortunately. And this goes along with that. So, you know, you've got this small town stereotype. Every time before we go into a town, we do the demographics. And like, you look at these small towns, the average age is about 5 years older. The average age of the person in that town is 5 years older than the average age in my town, right? The average age in the vineyard in that town is about 5 years younger than the average age of the people in my vineyard campus. So do you see what's happening there? Is there's plenty of churches there to reach older people. But, and the thing that has shocked us the most is the youth ministries in those towns. You know, it's disproportionately large compared to, you know, like the Paxson Vineyard, 225 people there on Sunday, 50, 60 teenagers involved in their midweek. So there's lots of teenagers, lots of young families there. This is also one thing really cool about small town. It is so much easier to get people's attention in a small town. Everybody knows everybody's business in a small town. So, you know, if we pass out, let's just say there's the 4th of July parade, and we pass out ice pops, you know, at the 4th of July parade. If we do that in Champaign-Urbana, that doesn't make the radar screen. We do that in small towns, like we just did it, you know, Labor Day last year, we did it. It's front page. It's front, the picture on the front page is the Vineyard Worship Band on the float going through town. And then, you know, this is what the Sullivan Vineyard does with parades, is they have these bright green t-shirts, you know, like the, you know, fluorescent road colors, and they say Sullivan Vineyard on them, and they follow the parade and pick up all the trash. And the people notice that. The town notices that. So then the city comes to them and it's like, would you guys pass out hot chocolate following this Christmas gala thing on the square? You know, so that it's so much easier to get a vibe in a small town. So our kindness outreach stuff has so much more impact in a small town. Reason 7, Jesus was from, this is all about Jesus and Jesus from a small town, right? So that's another reason. I needed 10 reasons. Now, like I mentioned, you know, like I'm over missions and, you know, some of you go to all the mission stuff and you can go to Vineyard Missions Leaders Meeting. You know, you go to any missions things. This is the thing. We and this applies to the States too, but we don't want to just start churches. We want to start church planning movements, okay? This is what most people don't know about church planning movements. I've been involved in firsthand research on this. Almost no church planning movements are taking place in urban areas. Almost all church planting movements are in rural areas. And like one of the foremost researchers on this is my good friend Dwight. And he said, you know, I asked Dwight, Dwight, you know, as I look at this and talk to people about this and read the stuff, the research articles and stuff on this, I said, it looks to me like these are all in rural areas. He's like, almost entirely. Now, I want you to turn to the person next to you and figure out why that's true. Why are church planting movements taking place in rural areas and almost never in urban areas? You see if you can figure it out, and then I'll tell you if you're right, okay? Stand up and do this. You're sleepy. Stand up. Find somebody. Try and figure this out. Okay, you figure it out? Go ahead and sit down and I'll take your answers on this. So why do you think it is that church planting movements are taking off in rural areas?
It's just more receptive.
More receptive? Okay. That may be part of it. Yeah.
I mean, everybody knows everybody, so they're more open to.
Okay, this Chris hit it. Everybody knows everybody. You can't start a church planting movement where not everybody knows everybody. So there is this is the dilemma. And this is why people tend to overlook rural areas, but they don't understand rural areas. There's this massive phenomenon taking place across the world. Now, Joel pointed out there's a reverse movement going on too. But people are moving into urban areas for economic reasons, because in most rural areas, there's not economic engines, right? If there were, they wouldn't be rural, because everybody would be moving there. Well, when people move to a new place, they're more open in a lot of ways. But if you reach them, you only reach that person, because they just left their family and friends behind. So, and this is, okay, so you're in a rural area. This is what I want you to understand. It takes longer, but once you're in with everybody. Do you see the difference there? And that, this is taking place around the world. And if you study these church planting movements, they don't go into a village and into a town and see instant results. It actually takes longer to see people come to Christ in a rural area. But then you see whole networks come to Christ. So that in, take Paxton, Illinois. And this is what jazzes our campus pastors. You know, when I have coffee with them, or breakfast with them, I'm like, how's it going? They're just like, I'm just so jazzed. So-and-so just came to Christ. And their life's just totally transformed, and their marriage is saved. And but this is like what happened in Paxton. So you go in there, Paxton, it's just, you know, it's been 4,500 people like for 100 years, you know? And right now, though, they just got like a zillion 300-foot-tall windmills put in, you know? So it just, like the school district's just getting $2 million more a year. All of a sudden, it's like you have oil here in eastern Ohio. We have lots of wind in Illinois. And we're finding out there's ways to harness that. But when Kenny comes to Christ, who last year was selling drugs to everyone in town, now he's bringing them all to the vineyard. Everybody knows Kenny in Paxton. Everybody knows that he's the guy that you used to go to for drugs. But you have people of influence in small towns who just are networked and connected. And this is what you pray for in small towns. I mean, you pray for this in big towns, too. This is what we pray for in every small town. And Ricky can tell you this, and I probably told this to Eric, too. So Ricky's working in Monticello, Illinois. And Eric's just starting a small group. This is towns where we don't have campuses, okay? Eric's starting a small group. Are you just starting this month, Eric? Or in the tattoo parlor in Covington, Indiana, okay? Just across the border from not far from our Danville campus. You pray for connectors. You pray for gatherers. Because, you know, I've talked to some of you during the break. You're like, I'm just moving there. I don't know anybody. That's what we're up against in Charleston this year. But there's people in that town that are connectors. So that Jesus goes into a town, he doesn't know anybody. The only person he reaches is the woman at the well. She's been married to half the town. Right? There's only 5 key families in that town, and she's married into all of them. Right? Or Peter goes into a town where he's never been before. Cornelius has connections there. You know, he's connected. And these people have, they're connectors. Sometimes they're connectors like the woman at the well because they've, you know, they're like Kenny, they're connected through drugs or something. Or sometimes they're connected because they've been the mayor or something. It doesn't matter. They're the connectors. So you pray for connectors. We'll talk about that more later because you will hear it comes into the stories of our campuses and how they started. So this is why the church planting movements are taking place in rural areas. It's easier to reach families and networks in small towns. And this is not true in many of the places where church planting movements are taking place. Because, you know, you find these church planting movements in Muslim countries, in Hindu countries. But in rural America, this is true. And we might as well take advantage of this. I've pastored in a town of 1,000. Even if you don't go to church, you feel guilty because you don't. You know? That is not true in Champaign-Urbana, a university town. You know? A lot of those people think Christians are evil. You know? And the problem with the world. But not in a small town. You know, this is like Paxton. So we've got this, our facilities in the center of town, like Joel said. Every year they set up, they take the just in front of the vineyard on the corner, vineyard's on a corner in the center of town, and in the middle of the intersection is a manhole, and they take the manhole cover off, and they find the biggest tree in town and cut it down, the biggest evergreen tree in town, cut it down, they find it in somebody's lawn in town, and they stick it in the manhole, and they decorate it. And then, you know, then they have this lighting of the tree ceremony, and the vineyard passes out hot chocolate there. This is a different town where we pass out hot chocolate. And then, you know, they're like, would you guys open your building? Could we, like, have the program in there after we light the tree? And they didn't do this last year, but this year they did this. Would you have somebody who would tell the Christmas story to the children who come to the Christmas lighting? That would never, that would go to court in Champaign-Urbana. That's, the mayor asked you to do that in Paxton, you know? So that's, you know, go there. People are more open there. It's much easier to get building permits. So we're in Urbana. It's just, when we build, there's a city arborist that assesses the impact of our building on trees. And if we cut down 4 trees, we better plant 20 more. Okay, this is in the town of 100,000. So we build a building in Sullivan, and we're there, they're pouring the foundations and so, and we're like, how hard was it to get the building permit for this? And they're like, oh, we haven't gotten it yet. We'll go get it this afternoon. So they go get the building permit that afternoon, of course. I mean, you just walk in and get it, right? And then this happened last week. I just heard this story Wednesday. So, the inspector comes by. I mean, in Urbana, I mean, the inspectors, we're adding on right now, and we're behind schedule. And it's largely like, hey, could the inspector come and inspect this? And they're like, no, he's on vacation. You know, he'll come back after Christmas, you know? I mean, we have to, everything stops. We don't dare, like, drive one nail without that inspection, you know? In Sullivan, where we're building right now, the inspector, they told me this happened last week. The inspector comes to the building. It's like half done. He comes to the building, you know, so I don't know what this is, 18,000 square feet or something. He comes to the building. You know, first of all, we buy 18 acres of land for $8,000 an acre. Okay? You cannot buy 1 acre for what we paid for those 18 acres. Okay? So then now we're putting a building on it. The inspector comes. He walks up to the front door, looks in through the glass, and says, "Everything looks fine." We're just like, "You're kidding." They're like, "No. No, that's what we were expecting, you know?" The second reason, God likes to work in overlooked people and places. I mean, any place we're planting vineyards, I don't care where we go, we're going to get the overlooked people. That's who we're going to get, right? When you go to a small town, you're just like, I mean, the whole town's overlooked, right? They don't get money from the Illinois state government. You know, they don't get the road projects. They don't, they're used to kind of being looked at like Jesus was looked at from Nazareth. And I mean, isn't that like the place where God's going to want to work, right? And then people, I mean, Joel said this, Ross said this, Mike and Trish said this, but you know, that's the number one reason that we need to go to small towns is those people need God. They're not, even if we have a vineyard in a big town, 20, 30 miles away, the people that need God, you know, the people that already find God, they might like, "Oh man, let's go learn about the Holy Spirit and healing. Let's get in on some awesome worship." But the people that need God, they're not going to, we've got to go to them. That, I mean, that is the gospel, right? That is what Jesus did. He came to us. He didn't say, "You guys come to me." He came to us. And, you know, I could just, like Ross was doing, I could just tell story after story. I always think of one guy, though. Whenever I think of, like, who wouldn't have met Jesus? And there's an older guy named Don. He's in his 70s. And, you know, we started this vineyard in his town. And somebody invited him to Alpha. And he was one of those guys at Alpha that, like, they're like, "Man, let's just put him in a group with a few other people like him. Because it seems to kind of mess up the group, you know?" And he met Jesus there, and his life was totally changed. And his wife is just so thankful, you know? Like, "I have an amazing husband now. I liked him before, but I really like him now, you know?" And I don't think anybody would have reached him, you know, if we hadn't started a church in that town. I don't think he would have been reached. And not only he, but other people in his immediate family wouldn't have reaped the benefits of that.